Welcome to module 6.1, and in this module we'll talk about virtual machines. Virtual machine is chapter 7 of the book. I hope all of you have purchased that book. There's an e-copy. Please do purchase that book. It's worthwhile, and that'll be a good reference. Not only you'll enjoy that, right? So now, whatever I'm going to cover is part of chapter 7 of that book. Now, virtual machine, why virtual machine? So, I have an high level language. In our case, it is going to be called Jack, which is slightly abridged form of Java. Now, already I have my hack, which is my hardware, and that had a machine language for which I have an assembler also. Now, converting from HLL directly to this machine language is a nightmare. Right, it's going to be a nightmare. So that is one of the reason we put one more level, which is a virtual machine, meaning I'm not going to make a hardware for this machine, but I'm going to define one more layer, and this machine will have an input language, and it will have an interpreter which will convert it into an output language. And what is that output language? This will be the assembly language or whatever the .asm files that you see, assembly language mnemonic. Once I get this assembly language mnemonic, whose assembly language? Hack's assembly language. Once I get this assembly language mnemonic, I can use my assembler to make it into binary and execute, right? So, now you understand more of this. So, Jack is a language that has a compiler. That compiler will compile it into the input language of your virtual machine. Now, then there is an interpreter which will take the input language of the virtual machine and convert it into an assembly language mnemonics. And then the assembler will take it and then make it into a machine binary and execute. This I have been explaining. Again, I am explaining it for sake of clarity. So, what are we going to do in this particular module? We define what is the input language for the VM, and now we define. So, this input language, say, will have something like 10 instructions or 10, no, we can't say, I don't want to say instructions, 10 commands, and each one of this command I should now translate it into a assembly language mnemonic of hack. So, for each of this command, say, let me say C1, C2 or C0, C1, C2 to C9, I will get a routine which will be in assembly mnemonic of hack. So, for each of these command, I will get an assembly language equivalent, say C0, C1 to C9, right? And this is what we are going to do here. Now, what is the biggest advantage of having this virtual machine? Is that I could have several programming languages, PL1, PL2, PL3 till PLN. Now, I have one virtual machine. From this virtual machine, I could have several interpreters which can give it for hardware architecture 1, hardware architecture 2, hardware architecture 3. Okay. And then I have an assembler which will take it to the actual hardware. Okay. So, multiple compilers running on multiple architectures, multiple languages supported on multiple architectures. This is what the virtual machine basically ensures us, right? I could have some language. So, what it means to invent a new programming language? This is some PL new, and as long as I have a compiler which will make it into this virtual machine, then that program of PLN can execute on all these architectures. You get it? Similarly, what it means to now introduce a new architecture. So this is one side of the story. Suppose I am putting a new architecture H of n, right? And if suppose I am H of new, suppose I am getting assembler for this and an interpreter for this, which will convert. So I have an assembler and an interpreter which will make from VM, it will interpret it into the assembly, right? So the moment I have that interpreter, that means all these languages PL1 to PLN can basically execute on my new architecture. So this means this approach of having a virtual machine will basically allow you to start inventing new architectures and use all the existing software on top of it with some lot amount of ease, right? And similarly, keep inventing new programming languages and keep and make it executable on all the existing architectures very quickly. If suppose this virtual machine did not exist and I make a programming language, then basically I have to do for every architecture another compiler, which will make it totally useless, right? It's impossible, right? Similarly, when I put suppose this virtual machine does not exist and I create a new new hardware, then for every programming language I need to have a separate software stack for it. Now all these things are avoided by the virtual machine, and that's the power of virtual machine. This concept was an old idea. In 1970s it started, but it came back in full spirit in the 1990s when C sharp and Java started using this as a concept, right? So what we will do in this particular thing is that we basically understand this virtual machine in its proper perspective. The virtual machine that we are going to use is a stack based virtual machine. Stack is a data structure where it supports two commands, push and pop. In addition, on this is basically data instructions into the stack. I can push an element, I can pop an element, and there is always something called a stack pointer, which will point to the top of the stack. And So let us do simple operations. So there is a stack, there is a stack pointer, there is a stack pointer. Initially it will be pointing to 0. Let me say these are all the memory locations. Stack is implemented on your data memory, right? So 0, 1, 2, 3 is there. Suppose I say push A, so A will come here, and your So A will come here and your stack pointer will now point to this. Now I say push B, now A will come here, B will come here, now your stack pointer will point to this. Now I say pop, then what will happen? This B will be coming out, so it will return a value. B will come here and your stack pointer will now start pop. We may erase this or not, but normally we erase it for security reasons, okay. So now when I say pop, then the topmost comes out. So B went last in and it came out first. So this stack follows what you call as the LIFO policy, that is last in first out policy. Now, in addition, in this stack, I can do some operations. Like for example, I have pushed 7, I have pushed 6, and the stack pointer is here. I can say add. What will add do? It will pop the first top two operands. Now, let me say I have pushed 1 also here or 10 here, and my stack pointer is pointing here. Then I say add. This will pop 10 and 6. It will add it and again push it. So what will happen is at the end of this, this will be 7, 10 and 6 are popped And again, it's sad at 16. So 16 goes here, and then I have SP. So this is how I do what we call as stack arithmetic. Your entire virtual machine is based on this stack. So we'll have stack data movement, and we'll have what we call as stack arithmetic. Right? Then we can also do some simple operations like, you know, compare. So I can say if x is less than 7 or y equal to 8, right? So I will say push x, push 7, okay, less than, push y, push 8 equal to r. This is a statement completely. So what will happen is, initially stack is empty, now I push x, then I push 7, so this is done, then I say less than, the stack pointer will be pointing here, okay. Now when I say less than, the second bottom is compared with the first bottom, so I say x is less than 7. And what will this less than operation do? It will pop the first two operands, first top two, it will compare the bottom with the top, like x is less than 7, right? And if it is really less than 7, it will push 1, otherwise it will push 0. So let me say x is 4 and y is 8, okay? So now this will be 4. Now the moment less than executes, 7 will be compared with, 4 will be compared with 7 for less than. Yes, 4 is less than 7. So what will happen is, these two will be popped out and the answer will be written 1. 1 means true, and the stack pointer will be there. So what less than will do? It will pop down the two entries, compare them in that order, bottom in the left hand side and top on the right hand side, because less than is not a commutative operator. A less than B is not B less than A, right? So we have to be careful of which is on the left hand side and which is on the right hand side. And then the answer is, if it is true, 1 will be pushed, if it is false, 0 will be pushed. I will say, if just for to make the life a little more interesting, y equal to 7. Now I push y. Now when I push y, what will happen? Stack pointer will go up. Now y is equal to 7. Then I push 8, right? That is a constant. So now the stack pointer is now here. Now I say equal to. So 8 and 7 are popped. So this will pop 8 and 7 and it will compare them. So 7 is not equal to 8, so it will put 0. So the answer is 0 and that will be pushed. So at the end of this, you will have 1, 8 and 7 are of course popped, and now 0 is pushed, right? And the stack pointer will be. So this will be the status of the stack after this. Then I show R. R again will take 0 and 1 and it will do an R. And the answer would be here 1. So this essential expression basically gets evaluated like this. So this is how I can meaningfully use stack to do certain logical comparisons also, right? So this is all this. So our virtual machine is going to be a stack based machine, and now we will see in the next modules what is the input language to this virtual machine. And for every instruction in that language, we will have something like 10 instructions. We will see what is the equivalent assembly mnemonics of hack. Of course, now we have an assembler, so we can afford to write it in assembly mnemonic and take it forward, right? So we will now meet again in module 6.2. Thank you.